Very good morning to all of you. Welcome to this special interest group on India and China special lecture. Before I start introducing our distinguished guest today, I have a request to make. Please switch off your mobiles or keep it in silent. Thank you very much. So as you know, we all are aware, today we are very blessed to have amongst us one of the most distinguished diplomats that we have been blessed with, Ambassador Shivshankar Menon. Of course, sir doesn't need any introduction, but it's customary to have introductions, and so therefore, as part of that tradition, let me do the usual ritual. Ambassador Shivshankar Menon is a distinguished fellow currently in the Foreign Policy Program at Brookings. His long career in public service spans diplomacy, national security, atomic energy, disarmament policy, and India's relations with its neighbors and major global powers. In 2010, he was chosen by Foreign Policy magazine as one of the world's top 100 global thinkers. Ambassador Shivshankar Menon currently also serves as chairman of the advisory board of the Institute of Chinese Studies in New Delhi. He is the author of a book which has come out recently, 2016. The book is titled Choices Inside the Making of Indian Foreign Policy. Sir has served as Foreign Secretary of India from October 2006 to August 2009 and as Ambassador and High Commissioner of India to Israel, Sri Lanka, China and Pakistan. As High Commissioner of India to Pakistan, Ambassador Menon restored High Commissioner level relations after a gap of a year and a half and initiated what is so far considered to be the best period in the two countries' relationship. He also served as India's Ambassador to China, restoring relations following the Indian nuclear weapons tests of 1998. During his service in the Ministry of External Affairs from 1992 to 1995, Ambassador Menon negotiated the first boundary-related agreement between the Republic of India and the People's Republic of China, the root of subsequent series of agreements that have maintained peace on the border despite ongoing boundary disputes. So with these few words, of course I can go on and on and on, but the purpose of having sir is actually to, share his wisdom with us. So sir, please welcome.
Thank you very much for that very generous introduction. Mr. Krishnan, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for asking me to speak to your special interest group on China. I was asked to speak on China and the world, and what I'd rather do is really speak for a few minutes and then maybe listen to you and answer questions and discuss the topic. But what I'll try to do just to start us off is to describe what China looks like today, because I think a lot of what China does is because of China's own internal condition today, and what that means for the world, and therefore for India-China relations, which is our primary or concern. I think everybody knows about what China has achieved in the last 30 years, the market changes, the accumulation of hard power. No other country in history has developed as fast or as quickly as China has, growing at around 10% for almost 30 years after she began reform open door policies in 1978. In fact, the only country that's comparable is really India, which has done over 30 years of 6% plus growth. And the interesting thing is that if you look at it from India's point of view, the relative, by every metric of power, economic, political, military, we have actually improved our position against every country in the world except China in the last 30 years. And I think that's part of our mental problem. One reason why, but I'll come to that later, one reason why I think we either try and ignore China as though it doesn't exist, and we try and behave as though what China, or we obsess about it and have this narrative of failure that's doomed to a terrible relationship and so on. I don't know which is true, but anyway, I'll come to that. But as a result of what China has done, to come back to what China's like, You know, she today has, in DPP terms, she has GDP parity with the US. In nominal terms, she's probably catching up pretty fast. She is at least two-thirds US GDP in standard exchange rate terms. She's the world's largest manufacturer by a considerable margin. She's the world's greatest trading nation, again by a considerable margin. She determines world commodity markets, prices, and how they behave. And she has the second largest military budget in the world. Now that is something. When you think of how rapid that is in 30 years for that to happen in history, there's never been a case. I mean, Britain, at the height of the Industrial Revolution, was growing at 3.2-3.5%. You compare that with this, and you get a sense of the scale and the acceleration. So that has tremendous consequences in the future. That has tremendous consequences for China itself, for the society, for the system, for the state, for the government, for how they run themselves. And not all of them are positive, because people take a while to get their minds around change when it's so fast. But more than that, systems, bureaucratic systems, and China is really the world's biggest bureaucracy. That's really what it is. I think, wrong to think of it as a state and so on. It's really a bureaucracy which works like a bureaucracy. And given that, it's very hard for these to adapt to such rapid change. Today, for instance, the regime's capacity to control society and to continue one-party rule is actually much less than it was before. So you have this peculiar paradox. An accumulation of hard power, military, etc., and a great deal of power in the hands of the state, but much less capability of actually determining what happens in society, what happens to people's lives. Got to one figure, less than half the Chinese today earn their living from the state or state-owned enterprise. That's a huge change from a time when 100% every Chinese depended for everything and his living certainly on the state. And she faces a middle-income trap. Growth has slowed. If you, depending on who you ask, Chinese official figures say 6.9, 6.6%, but other people will tell you it's now down to anywhere between 2 and 4%, actually. But she does need to shift from her earlier model of export-led growth, because world markets have been closing. In fact, global trade shrank until last year, after 2008. And from this investment-led pattern of growth, where she had a savings rate at one stage, which was close to 46% of GDP, but it's now dropped a little bit. But this investment-led growth model has actually led to huge overcapacity, has led to inefficiencies in the system, and essentially the same non-performing assets problem in the financial system, which they took them off the books of the banks. They now show up as debt, which is around 274% of GDP, which is no small amount. So they have to shift, and they recognize this, they've been saying this for 5 years, to a domestic consumption-led growth, and to develop their own domestic markets and private consumption within the... The result of this situation, where domestic debt is so high, where there's a real estate bubble, an asset bubble actually, where, is that Moody's has actually downgraded Chinese investment last month. At the same time, China is more important to the world economy than ever before. The slowing world economy makes it hard for her to go on growing on the basis of exports, but she matters much more to the world. If you look at the sources of global growth, where are they today? If you want to grow the world economy. In fact, last year, more than half the world's growth came from four economies, and China was number one among them, almost 28% or so, according to one figure. India comes next after that. That's where the sources of growth. And so China becomes more important in the world when she faces bigger problems at home, all at the same time. This is why politics is so fascinating, and this is the best part of it, because it's never a linear sort of... But it's... The CCP's ability to control her own society is also under threat because of technology, because of ICT, and you see a progressive tightening of the great Chinese firewall, but people are ingenious, they find new ways. Today they banned, last month they banned VPNs. But you know, there'll always be another way around it. And technology by its nature itself, especially ICT, is subversive in the sense that it empowers small individuals and small groups. It empowers the state also in terms of surveillance, in terms of what it can do, but it equally shifts the balance of power in favor of the little man. So for the last few years, since 2008, the Chinese state has consistently and explicitly said that stability above all else, one thing the other, each year, and that stability is the highest goal of the system. And that reflects, to my mind at least, the fragility that they sense, that the leadership themselves sense within the society and the economy. So what happens? When you have diminished capacity to drive reform, to drive the domestic agenda, and you see external stress, a slowing global economy, you tend towards authoritarian leadership, which promises more and more, and looks for legitimacy to nationalism or ultra-nationalism. It's not a phenomenon that's unique to China, by the way. But if you look at Abe, Xi Jinping, Modi, Trump, I mean Trump, the West is actually catching up with it, what Asia began in 2012. And it's a normal reaction, because people want solutions to the problems they see. They expect a government to promise them. And these are all authoritarian centralizers. You see a degree of centralizing going on in China, which you have not seen for many, many years, not since Mao Zedong time. And Mao Zedong didn't have the means to do it. This regime today does have that means. And their legitimacy has shifted, where Mao Zedong was essentially offering an ideological legitimacy, where a communist regime started socialism, but we're going to bring us all up to communism. Deng moved that after the failure of the Cultural Revolution. He shifted that to get rich as glorious, to an economic justification. We'll grow enough that you will be sure we'll make you rich, ultimately. The economy slows, the world economy slows, but your economy also slows. And people can no longer answer as confidently that their children will be much better off than they are today. So where do you go? You go to nationalism. So you have this strange situation of a regime, diminished capacity at home, a worsening international situation, international economic situation, promising much more, because for its legitimacy you're relying on nationalism, and also convinced that its own future depends on shaping the rest of the world now. If something like 44% of your GDP is external merchandise trade, you can't just say, okay, I forget the world, I'll do domestic markets and I'll grow on my own. You need to shape that environment because it matters so much to you. So you become assertive, you have ultra-nationalism, you become much more assertive. And that's exactly what we've seen China doing in the world since 2008 onwards, after the economic crisis. Now people will tell you, oh, you know, they thought their moment has come, the West is collapsing. It's not that simple. It's because of their own domestic needs that they need to do it. It's not that if tomorrow the West stands up and the US is doing well, they're going to go back into their shell. No. But they need that external, to shape that external environment. And you see it happen in each sphere. In 2015, April, they issue a white paper on military strategy, which moves the PLA's task from being homeland defense and coastal waters to actually projecting power. They reorganize the whole PLA into commands, joint commands, like theater commands, like the US Army or the US Armed Forces, so that they can actually project power. They start building bases abroad, Djibouti, which is just open, Gwadar. I mean, it applies in every sphere. South China Sea, you see China pushing. You see China pushing in the East China. But this stems from a domestic cause, and my point is, this is not just a reaction to what's happened in the world or to an opportunity. It stems from the need to be able to shape that external environment and because of the nature of the regime that we're dealing with. So she's expanded her security perimeter. Deng Xiaoping's general strategic line was very simple. Remember, the 24-character strategy was hide your lights, never take leadership, and build up your own capacities at home. And they did that for many years, from 1978 onwards. They slipstreamed the US. They let the US do what she wanted. They voted with the US on Iraq in the first Gulf War. They let whatever the US was doing, while they concentrated on building up their own strength. But post-2008, in today's situation, they can no longer do that, for the reasons that I've explained. So you have Xi Jinping now actually talking of how China needs to strive for achievement. It's a very different attitude, that we need to show our responsible nature. We need to go out and take responsibility for what happens in the world. This is completely different from hiding your lights and sitting at home. So she's expanded her security perimeter, her definition of core interests. Until 2006, the Chinese defined their core interests as the two terrible T's, Tibet and Taiwan. That was it. Then they added South China Sea in 2006. By 2008, it became official. And now it's slowly growing. If you look at what they're saying, they're talking about China's territorial integrity, which includes, therefore, all the lost territories. They talk of the great rejuvenation of China, but in the Chinese, it reads as a great rejuvenation of the Chinese race, the Zhonghua Minzu. It's not just, which means every overseas Chinese, does it include Singapore? It's a Chinese country by their definition. They expect anticipatory compliance. So they're slowly expanding the definitions of what they regard as China's core interests. So we are dealing, therefore, not just with the changed China and changed Chinese behavior abroad, but also with the changed Chinese statecraft. And I think we have seen this most obviously in Doklam. And this really brings me to India-China relations. If we have had, well, a mixed record on dealing with the Chinese, to put it mildly, we ended up in a war in 62. But since the late 70s and the 80s, really, we've been successful in managing this relationship, both sides, together, in making sure that it stays peaceful, that while that we don't bother each other while we go off and do our own business. In other words, while we grew at 6% plus, while the Chinese did their own domestic consolidation and build-up. And the basis of that understanding, which was formalized during the Rajiv Gandhi visit in December 1988, was quite simple. We have differences. We have the world's biggest boundary dispute, for instance. We have other problems. You bother about us and the Tibetans, we bother about you and our insurgent groups in the Northeast. There are a long list of problems, but we will keep discussing those and settle them peacefully. We will not allow them to erupt into actual conflict. When it comes to areas where we can work together, we will cooperate. For instance, we'll build our trade and economic relations and so on. We'll do whatever we can. And on the international stage, if we have a common interest, we'll work together, which we did. If you look at what happened, we signed a border peace and tranquility agreement with China in 1993, which is quite simple. Both sides will respect the status quo. We'll not change the status quo by the use of force. And then we did a whole series of CBMs, of troop concentrations, of air intrusions, of how we handled whatever, because frankly, there's no agreed definition of the status quo. There's no one line. So when he thinks he's doing what he's done before, we think it's an intrusion. When we do what we think we've always done, he thinks it's an intrusion. But we have a way of dealing with it, a standard operating procedure which goes down to, when you see him, raise banner number one. If he doesn't leave after 20 minutes, raise banner number two. If nothing happens after 30 minutes, both sides turn around, go home, raise it at the commander's meeting, etc., etc. I mean, we had it down pat. And the last death on that border happened in 1975, October, at Kurunda, by accident, in the fog. Nobody has died since then. It's actually been, if you think of it, in practical terms, our most peaceful border, compared to the most defined border, which is Pakistan, where you have an LOC on a map signed by the DGMOs, everything laid down, internationally agreed boundary as well. And yet, look at what goes on across there in terms of violence. And here, you've actually managed, because both sides had an interest in keeping this quiet, you built trade up from roughly $2 billion in 2002 $73 billion. Very terrible balance from your point of view, but you did build up the trade and the economic relationship. You are now actually China's sixth largest export market. So you now start mattering to China, even in an economic sense. You have 10, or rather 13,000 Indian students studying in China today, which, you know, shows you the level of sort of interaction. So that relationship has grown, and you work together in the WTO in Doha round on climate change. You worked together for a while until Paris. You managed, the basic countries managed to work together. So where you had a common interest internationally also. So that modus vivendi worked and carried you through and left you free to go off and do your other more important business, which is transforming India, in that case transforming China. But it's broken down. It's clearly under stress today. And the signs of stress, you know, you've seen in the papers, you know, whether it's listing Masood Azhar, whether it's membership in the NSG. And you see the difference. In 2008, when we went to the NSG for the exemption, I went to China twice, spoke to the Chinese. Chinese said, we will not be the ones to stand in your way. So I came back, everyone said, oh, wonderful, Chinese support us. I said, no, they never told you they support you. They've told you they will not be the last man standing in the room opposing you. That's all. So they will put everybody else up to opposing you. And sure enough, when we worked on everybody else and they dropped off, on the morning of 6th of September, when we got our clearance, Chinese sent us a letter saying we are happy to support you. So okay, but that's one way of doing business. By the time we came to asking for membership last year, 3 weeks before the formal NSG meeting, they published an article in the newspapers in Peking, saying this is all wrong, why is India demanding membership, and so on. So they made it quite clear that you couldn't even go around them. And they'd already nailed their colors to the mast, as it were. This is a very different attitude. But that's only one. I mean, you have a whole series of examples where basically that whole modus vivendi no longer works and the relationship is under stress. Is that my mic? So you have a situation where you have really three choices. I mean, you can choose to put up with it or and face all the unpredictable consequences that come from that, because you never know where these situations are going to end. Secondly, you can accept these new Chinese terms for the relationship, which is accept China's primacy. That's what Belt and Road in effect amounts to. Accept China's primacy in the region, in the Asia Pacific, and work with us, but on our terms. Now there is no way that we can do that when that actually impinges on our territorial integrity. When you look at CPEC, for instance, what is it? It's a permanent Chinese state in Indian territory, which is under Pakistani occupation, and therefore in continuing Pakistani occupation of that territory. So there's no way any government of India can accept that. So you might live with the rest of the BRI. I mean, in practice, if you look at it, Colombo Port 5 and 6 was built by the Chinese. But 83% of what goes through Colombo Port is to or from India. So the Chinese have built infrastructure and you're getting the use of it. I don't think that's a bad deal. But as long as that's the deal, but large chunks of BRI actually make no economic sense. No rates of return, economic rates of return, they justify it. But it's the strategic bits that are being built first, rather port, for instance. None of those power plants along that road, CPEC, are being built. They're still arguing about the terms of the contracts and so on. So when you start seeing strategic intent behind these, in the long run, maybe it won't work. I don't think, frankly, any such long, huge project like this, or set of projects like this, can work purely on putting money where you want it to go, but where you're not making any return. And you're already running 274% GDP of debt. I mean, there's a limit to this. But that's the long term, that's 5-10 years from now. Between now and then, you have to deal with those consequences. So it's hard for us to just accept that situation. So what's the third alternative? The alternative really then is for you to sit with the Chinese and work out a new modus vivendi. for this relationship. The one from 88 might have worked so far, but you have to accept that not only have they changed, you have changed. We've also changed our definition of what our interests are. When we started reform in 1991, about less than 18% of our GDP was merchandise trade. Now, by 2014, we went all the way up to 49.3%. That's almost half our GDP. And more than half of that went east, which means it went through the South China Sea. So the South China Sea really matters to us today. It's dropped since then because world trade, Shanghai trade, etc. But basically, we're way over 40% already. So South China Sea today becomes an interest for you. Freedom of navigation in the South China Sea matters to you in a way that it never did before, which is why we now talk about it and offend the Chinese, who say this is now their territory, which they didn't used to say in 1990. Their first letter to the UN about the Nine Dash Land was in 1996. So their interest, their definition of their interest has grown, our definition has grown. We rub up against each other in the periphery. And that's, again, normal, because our periphery is their periphery is yours. You object when they go into Sri Lanka, they go into Myanmar, they go into Bangladesh. But they equally object to your being in Vietnam, deciding to sell Brahmos to Vietnam. They object to what you're doing with the Japanese, because they see this all as part of the encirclement of, certainly they object to what you say to the Mongols and so on. So there's, you have mirror imaging going on here, and you need to create a new sense of can you find a new modus vivendi. Now, there will be different answers to the question, can you not? Many people will say it's impossible. I don't think so. Why don't I think so? Because if you look at the actual core interests that both sides still define for themselves, they're not actually either in conflict with each other, or they can be managed. You know, when they say territorial integrity, and in other words, all of Arunachal is part of China, is southern Tibet, but you also have claims against them in Aksai Chin and so on. But you have managed that so far, successfully. And you have both made sure that it hasn't exploded. Question is, are they willing to? You will only know if they are willing to continue to do that, if you actually engage them. You sit them down at a table and talk to them, and then talk across the range of issues that affect them, that affect you, and see whether you can or not. For me, there are some obvious things where you should be working together. Maritime security, for instance. They keep saying they have no objection to freedom of navigation in the South China Sea. It's only they want recognition of their territorial claim. I don't think we should give them recognition of their territorial claim because they have claims against us. But if they have no problem with freedom of navigation, that's our primary interest, South China Sea. We have no territorial claims. So maritime security for me, they are held hostage in the Indian Ocean. And Hu Jintao used to say that China has a Malacca dilemma. They also have a Hormuz dilemma. And you do have the ability and the power in the Indian Ocean, actually, to affect their security, the safety of all the energy and their trade that flows through the Indian Ocean. So you have actually trade-offs, or at least areas where you can work your interests together. It'll take work, and it'll take a lot of practice to get used to actually doing it in practice. But to my mind, this is worth doing. It's worth trying. Even the exercise of doing this in itself helps to clarify and helps to prevent misunderstanding in various ways. Where will it end up? I can't answer it, because if you look at it logically, it makes no sense yet for either China or India, before we have achieved our goals, to actually end up wasting our energy on getting into trouble with each other. I mean, we obviously have so much to do left to transform India. Well, in terms of poor people, sick people, you know, whatever, you name it, literacy, everything. We have so much to do at home. Whereas for the Chinese as well, they define their goals as doubling their income by the centenary of the Communist Party, which is 2021, which they've actually already done. And of being a relatively prosperous country by the centenary of the People's Republic, which is 2049, the China Print, the 100. Now, if that's what they want to do, surely they should stay out of trouble. But, you know, there's no guaranteeing human foolishness. I mean, people do stupid things. And you have to accept that as part of you know, of politics, I think. And what is worrying for me is that China seems to be in a great hurry. Why is she pushing so hard? If history is on her side, if all this is inevitable, what's the hurry? Why do you need to push in South China Sea? Why do you need to push in Doklam? Why do you need to push in the East China Sea? Why are you busy doing Belt and Road and trying? Just do the projects one by one. Build your new global order from the bottom up if you want. Why can't you do that? I think there's three fundamental reasons. By 2040, China will be as gray or old as Japan is today, which is today the greatest major economy, advanced economy in the world. So I think when the Chinese say we have a window of strategic opportunity, it's a window that closes, and closes relatively fast. Secondly, I think they don't expect that their present economic opportunity that they see for themselves, of Europe's down, the US needs growth. If you look at major US corporations, they all, China's a huge part of their profits, 24% for Apple. Even for chemical companies like DuPont, it's 9% or so. You know, that level of dependency on China that the existing powers have, I don't think that's going to continue forever. And I don't think the Chinese expect it to either. At some stage, there will be a recovery, there will be a restructuring of those economies and a change. And most important, this political opportunity that Trump has really given them. He wound up TPP, he's gone home, he's ready to do deals on everything. Now, all the things he said in his campaign, whether it was trade, 45% tax on Chinese imports, China currency manipulator and sanctions, all of South China Sea, no way, we're going to push back, nothing, it's all gone. Why? To get China to cooperate on North Korea's nuclear weapon. And so, the US is obviously no longer interested in maintaining that balance in the Asia Pacific or in global order issues, and this is not an administration. But this is not the administration that's going to be there forever. So, in other words, this may be the moment of China's relative power being at its height, both for fundamental structural reasons, demography and other things about the economy, but even the international politics of it may not stay the way it is, in which case we're really in for a tough time. At least for the next 5 years, you're going to see a really pushy China. And because if they think this is the best time when they can do it, and that in the long run it's not going to be quite so easy, because other powers are rising, whether it's India, Indonesia, look at Korea. And you look at where each of these issues might go. Look at North Korea nuclear. If you do any kind of solution which leaves North Korea with nuclear weapons, you can't do an Iran because she's much more advanced than Iran, then it's inevitable that South Korea, Japan will end up nuclear weapon states. That's not what China wants. From China's point of view, that's a terrible outcome, to have more nuclear weapon states which are not her allies on her borders. It can't be her preferred outcome in Korea. Same thing in various other places. You look at the kind of defense, security, intelligence cooperation that countries on China's periphery have started doing now. All the way from Japan to Vietnam, Australia, Indonesia, India, etc. And that's not a good thing from their point of view. So, it's possible that they see this as their moment of relative power being at its height. And that in which case, then we're in for a tough 5 years of a pushy China, but not necessarily such a bad prospect in the long run. The thing to do for us, I think, is therefore, keep your head down, do exactly what Deng did vis-a-vis the US. When he didn't have the power to actually take them on, he kept his head down and built his own country up. Made alliances, pacified his periphery. He spent a lot of effort on ASEAN, on the neighbors, on keeping the peace in his immediate neighborhood. and making sure that his influence kept growing there. And then bothered, left the international system to its own devices and was purely opportunistic with the rest of it. And made the switch to a much more active policy only when he saw the relative balance of forces was in his favor. And in fact, it wasn't him, it was actually Xi Jinping who made the switch, but Hu Jintao in the last few years. So the prognosis, I'm afraid I have no simple answers to tell you for how all this is going to pan out, what's going to happen. But I think it's worth our while seeing if we can do a modus vivendi, a strategic modus vivendi, rework the one that we had and bring it up to date. But I think we should be prepared for some rough times in the next 4 or 5 years. Thank you. I'd be very happy to answer questions, but more important to hear what you have to say about it.
We have 20 minutes for the Q&A session. So, you know, we will take questions for the next 20 minutes. Just to make, if you know, things audible, we have the mics.
Good morning, sir. My question is on two fronts. One is on tactical front. Tactical front, and other is on the strategic front. And the tactical front. I'm Professor Bhatta from Information Systems area. From the tactical front, my question to you, sir, is that knowing Chinese psyche for so long, do you think we'll be getting it in armed conflict in the near future? If so, are we in a position to win such an armed conflict on the tactical front? On the strategic front, I have a question. Having been a diplomat throughout your life, have we gone somewhere wrong in our diplomacy towards China with Dalai Lama and other things? Has it been irritating them quite a lot that they are doing all these things to irritate us back?
Will we get an armed conflict? It takes two hands to clap. I can't answer for the Chinese. I don't think it's in their interest right now. I don't think it's in our interest. I don't see any gain from an armed conflict that justifies the cost. Remember one thing for the Chinese. Anything less than 62, which is a complete victory, is a failure. I mean, you know, people will ask him, what the hell? Your grandfathers could do this with almost nothing in their hands. What have you achieved? Today you have the capacity to embarrass the Chinese. Because he's a big power, small things are an embarrassment. Things which would not have embarrassed him when he was a tattered guerrilla roaming around in the jungle. And so there is a difference when you look at conflict. Now, I think what we need to figure out is, do we think he'll be rational? And is there a moment when he thinks that conflict serves his interest, that he has gains to make? I don't see that right now. And I, you know, it's hard to conceive of a situation like that. Unless you foresee really extreme cases of complete internal breakdown in China, you know, various other kinds of problems. You mentioned Tibet, for instance, and, you know, have we gone wrong in Tibet? You know, look at his situation in Tibet. Today he's actually, there's no real threat that Tibet is going to secede. I mean, he fought a guerrilla war in Tibet right through the late 50s, early 60s, I mean, until actually 74 when he wiped out Kushigangbo. And compared to that situation, he's actually much more comfortable in Tibet. Every Tibetan town except Yanxi is today Han majority. So I don't think he's so sensitive. What worries him about Tibet is the fact that what it does to China's image, and this is the difference. Today's China, it matters to him how the rest of the world regards him. And the example it sets also to Xinjiang, to Inner Mongolia, to other places. And that's part of his problem. But he's more sensitive today to these other factors, which he wasn't in the past, in the 50s and 60s. But as long as you assume that he's rational, it doesn't make sense to assume that there will be conflict. There could be skirmishes, there could be, you know, pushing, shoving, all that kind of thing could happen. But that could be an accident, or it could be due to local reasons. But in the larger sense, you know, he's been trying to convince the world that he's rising peacefully, that he's getting his way. And what will it do if he gets into a conflict with India? In 1962, in August, Mao Zedong told the Politburo, you know, we'll fight with India and win, and don't worry. In 30 years, they'll forget about it and we'll be back to normal. Has anyone forgotten in India? I mean, everybody in India, if you say 62, they're neuralgic about it. There's no question. And if he does start a conflict with India, it will do all the things that he says he doesn't want. Drive you into the American arms, make an implacable enemy of you, make you do much more with his other adversaries all the way across. I mean, there's no question. Look at what you did after 62. You created capacity steadily, slowly, until finally you were back at the line and you were able to deal with him in 67 at Nathula, and you were able to deal with him elsewhere. So in Wangdong, he saw the difference in Sundarongju. So I don't think, you know, that that particular problem, if you assume it's rational, if you assume it's irrational, then all bets are off. So which is why you have to prepare for it. Because you cannot just assume that everybody else thinks like you is going to be a rational actor. And history proves they're not. People are not rational all the time. I mean, it's proven in the marketplace every day when you look at what people buy. But that's... So you need to prepare for that eventuality. And if you're prepared for it, I think you can avoid it. Is our Tibet policy wrong? I don't think so, no. I don't think you should claim a policy... Well, let's look at the 50s and 60s. I don't think you should declare a policy which you can't enforce, which you don't have the power to back up. And many people say, oh, you should recognize Tibet as independent. For what? So they all get massacred, which is what happened anyway, but it wasn't because of you. I mean, I don't think you should go around claiming things that... Today, what Tibetan option are we talking about? The Dalai Lama himself says Tibet is a part of China, but we need to work out the terms of our autonomy with the Chinese. He offers a middle path. I think that's a sensible solution. We, since 2008, the Chinese have stopped asking us to endorse that Tibet is a part of China in all the joint statements. Why? Because in 2008, when they came and asked us, will you say this? We said, we'll say that, but we'll also say that why don't you talk directly to the Dalai Lama and deal with him? He also recognizes that it's part of China. So shall we put that in also? And they said no. And ever since then, they've stopped asking us to keep that. So I think, you know, today's situation is very different. Today, if you ask the Dalai Lama himself, what he says is most important is to preserve Tibetan identity and culture and the transmission of Buddhism, the practice and transmission of Buddhism. For him, these two things are critical. And that's what he has spent his life actually working on. He knows. Today some state might recognize, some state might sign an agreement, tomorrow it changes. There isn't a boundary in the world today which is the same as it was 200 years ago. Not one, not even the US, Canada. So he knows the value of that. For him, what has much more value is Tibetan identity, culture, and his religion, and Buddhism, its transmission. And I think that's what we have done best at actually maintaining. That's what we've done by keeping that community, by enabling them to do all this. I don't think that's bad policy at all. I think it's actually a far-sighted policy. But I think it would be stupid to make claims or to declare policies which you can't enforce, which you don't have the basis to actually go out and do. And I think, unfortunately, you hear a lot of that these days. You hear a lot of people who seem to have pretty exaggerated ideas of what we can or cannot do.
I am Kalshi Mukherjee. I am part of OBN HR area here. My question is that you said that in China, the power of the party or the bureaucracy on the state is progressively reducing.
No, their ability to determine outcomes. Okay. Their power is actually much more than it ever was.
Okay.
They can read it, they can listen to your conversations, do all kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but having said so, then what shape do you think the Chinese society would take in coming years?
It's interesting, you know, I was telling some of the students who I was talking to earlier. China is a contrast. You see many more acts of individual kindness on the streets in Beijing than you do in Delhi. Why? Because I think people compensate in their personal lives for their lack of power in the larger political, social sense. Because the state is so overwhelming there. And it's a very strange reaction. I don't know how to describe this. So when you say how is Chinese society developing, you look at some of the novels that are written, you look at some of the films that are made, you look at some of the poetry that's written, the modern art, for instance, is superb. It's because of the pressure of the state, because of the power of the state and its invasive nature, and the fact that it comes into your life in 1,000 ways. So you find other outlets. And you actually do better at those things. So where does society go? It's very hard to predict. They used to say Mao Zedong, Emperor of the Blue Ants, you know? Not at all. In fact, I'm struck by how unlike that characterization it is, this idea that China was going to be a wholly regimented. And technology is actually making it less and less easy to regiment or to control. That's my point. So you get a society which is, in some respects, there's still amnesia about, say, the Cultural Revolution, Tiananmen, about big political turning points. People, therefore, put all their energy into their children, their family, into their space, which they can control, making sure that, you know, they get good educations. The whole family will work to send the bright child out of the country. And this is it's a very different society from the one that either Mao or Deng or anyone predicted or wanted to build. And it's certainly not the society that the Communist Party wants. Religion is booming in China. But it's booming in Chinese conditions, I mean, as they say, with Chinese characteristics. Every monk, every priest in China, whether he is Catholic, Protestant, or Buddhist, is a state employee. He gets a salary from the state. He has a license to run his temple, church, whatever, from the state. And the state pays him. And it's booming. I mean, and this is long ago, in 2003, we got an invitation from a village in, I think it was Henan, saying, you know, we are Xuanzang, who came here, the monk, we are Xuanzang's home village, and we are reopening his family temple. Will you send something? So I sent a third secretary, young chap who spoke Chinese. And he came back gobsmacked. He said there were something like 4,000 people who had come walking across the hills from all over these villages to come for a temple inauguration. But what was more, the party secretary was sitting at the top table and watching the ceremony. So what does it tell you? It tells you the party is using religion. Because they realize that people have these needs, urges, whatever. And they use controllable forms of religion. Buddhism is Chinese, so it's all right. Catholicism is a problem because the Vatican claims extraterritorial rights to appoint bishops. As long as they do that, they won't let the Vatican in. But at the same time, people use the space this opens up in their own ways. They chose to do Xuanzang's. And they do their fancy marriage ceremonies, this, that. I mean, it's amazing what they do now when you see them all dressed up. It's a society which is changing almost as fast as ours. It's urbanizing very rapidly. So when you say, what is Chinese society going to be like? I don't know, but it's going to be something. And it's going to be something quite different from anything that we've ever seen anywhere in the world. Just like India is going to be quite different. And you look at the rate of change here, of everything. You look at women riding scooters, you look at, you know, these are things that 50 years ago you wouldn't have seen. And it's the same thing in China.
Can we now give chance to our students, you know, to ask some questions? Please.
I'm Tanay, I'm a second year student. Sir, as I've been reading about this issue in Doklam, so since 1962 there have been skirmishes in 67 and 86, but this one involves a third nation, Bhutan. And in the tri-junction, Chinese soldiers tried to construct a road, and India and Bhutan signed a treaty in 2007 that whenever there is a matter of their foreign policy or defense, they will have a say in each other's actions or whatever they plan about it. So, sir, what is the role of a third party like Bhutan in this? And since China does not have a very favorable view to the peace treaty signed between India, friendship treaty signed between India and Bhutan in 2007. So how will China look at India-Bhutan relations from now onwards?
Well, to go back to Doklam, I don't think this incident is comparable to previous incidents. So three reasons. One is Chinese chose to make trouble, to change the status quo, to decide to build the road at this time. Secondly, you look at the level of rhetoric that they're using, the way they describe it. This is an area, the plateau as a whole, Doklam as a whole. It's in their discussions with the Bhutanese, they've always accepted that there is a dispute over this area. And yet, if you look at all their publicity, the Chinese territory, how dare you come into Chinese territory, etc., etc. Thirdly, they, unlike in the past, when they would glide past the issue of India's obligations to Bhutan, this time they've been very explicit in denying them and trying to make sure that we have no rights, or to say in public that we have no rights. In fact, they've been publishing all kinds of stories that the Bhutanese are very angry with India and so on, as part of the propaganda. What it actually seems to suggest is actually a Chinese attempt to try and drive a wedge between you and Bhutan. It's the same thing. In the South China Sea, what were they doing? They were trying to show ASEAN and the other claimants that you can't rely on somebody else. You think you can rely on the US? They're not going to solve this. And they have managed in the South China Sea to make it a South China lake, actually. In effect, they built islands, bases, done what they have to. I mean, just because the US runs a ship through once every 6 months, it makes no difference to them. I think it's a similar tactic here, but I don't think they faced quite the same response. So now let's see where they go. We have dealt with standoffs and prolonged standoffs in the past. I mean, in Sundarumchu, Wangdong, when they came in 86 and sat, we also sat and we brought in force. And we sat there for a long time, for almost a little less than a decade. During that period, Arunachal became a state. They granted statehood. Rajiv Gandhi visited China. We signed the Border Peace and Tranquility Agreement. We actually negotiated it all. And then we wound down the standoff. But the standoff went on right through this. I mean, that's one way, one outcome that's possible. There are other outcomes, of course. I mean, somebody can make mistakes, somebody can fire a shot, something. Those are possible. There are also, but question really is, why did he do this? And so far, I haven't seen a really convincing answer why he chose to do this at this time. And you know, you must remember that what we know, and what I know from the media, like you know, what we know about who did what to whom, where, when, is never complete in this situation. So I think it's best to stay clear of the nuts and bolts of where it is. Look at the larger picture and see whether it's and analyze that part of it rather than and what it does to India-Bhutan relations. Well, if I were Bhutanese, I'd be even more reliant on India. I'd say, you know, I have to. But you never know. Let's see.
Morning, sir. I'm Arthur from PGP2. Sir, I have a question regarding China's interest in Sri Lanka. Recently, they have taken over Hambantota port over there. So, how do you see the balance of China and India and Sri Lanka when India has some stakes in this port? We call it Trincomalee. So, how do you see the strategic balance over there?
You know, you must accept the fact that A, you cannot have exclusive relations with your neighbors in today's world. One. Two, that every one of your littler neighbors will use India-China to get a good deal out of them and from you. If you were them, you'd do the same. I mean, you did do the same between the Soviets and the Americans in the 50s and so on when they were So this is, you have to accept some level of this as normal. Question is, what affects your interests? And you have to, and that's where the skill comes in, laying down your red lines very clearly and making sure that the Sri Lankan government respects that. Ambantota was a line that is a port that was built by the Chinese a long time ago, didn't work for many reasons, including the fact that there was a huge rock in the middle of the port, which for a long time they couldn't get rid of. But who goes to Hambantota? Nobody will go to Hambantota as long as Colombo is next door, and it's a wonderful port. In fact, and the best port in Asia is really Trinco. That's what everybody from the Royal Navy in the 19th century used to say. So this is really why we suspect Hambantota. Not because she owns it or she didn't own it before, but she used it. Because if it has no commercial use, then who's going to use it? PLA Navy? Submarines? Is that what they're building in? So far, they haven't done the ancillary things that it would be. But if you own the port, and it was sitting there idle, and there was a huge, busy port, commercial port next to you, after 2-3 years, your mind would start thinking bad thoughts. It's natural. So I think that's what worries us about Hambantota. Now, you still have time to do what you can, with the Sri Lankans, with the Chinese also, if you want. I mean, there's nothing stopping you from actually going and talking to them at the same time. They might not listen to you, but so what? You let them be known. So let it be known what you think and what, and draw your lines clearly. But don't draw lines which either hurt your partner. You know, don't tell people, oh, don't let the Chinese build a port for you. Why should he forego having a port and making money for you, unless you offer him something better? And that effort you have to make. It's not enough to this sense of entitlement that this is my neighborhood, so you have to listen to me, and I have exclusive rights here. You have to change that mentality and the way you look at it. And that's going to be complicated. Whether you like it or not, China will be in your periphery, and you're in their periphery also. I mean, you can use Kamran Bay, you can do what you want, you know, in other places, and you do. So it's, what I'm trying to say is it's much more, you know, you need to take a more round, it's not a question of, oh, they've won one, now we've won another. China's playing Go, they're not playing chess or checkers.
I am Prasad. I came
here. Mic.
I am Prasad, item 4. So my doubt, with respect to the media, I think the escalation when there's a parallel diplomatic channel which is working in the China. So I wanted to know how important is it to tone down the tone with respect to the rhetoric which the media plays, pumping in emotions on either side.
I have a different view. I like the media yelling at each other. So Chinese media yelling, let our media yell, as long as the governments know what they're doing. And that they don't, you know, this is, we make the mistake of saying Chinese state-owned media all the time. Yes, it's all state-owned, but it has different functions. Global Times' job is to be provocative and make sure that China's view gets onto the front page of other people's paper. So it's like Times Now. It'll say, you know, whatever it can to get TRPs and headlines. Same thing on our side. I mean, well, now Republic, or whatever. So, let them yell at each other. Why does it bother you? Why? And as government, the last thing you should do is to control them. Because if you control them, then tomorrow everything they say you are responsible for. Why are you taking this responsibility on yourself? As long as governments are talking to each other, are clear with each other, and understand each other, and know how to deal with the situation, that's fine by me. The rest of it is noise. And enjoy the show. It's good entertainment.
There has been a standoff between between China and Philippines regarding South China Sea. So Philippines are also saying that we will change the name of the sea on their part. So why not India is coordinating with Philippines in this South China Sea issue?
You know, Philippines has gone hot and cold, hot and cold. In December 2012, they got into a confrontation in two places, Mr. Freef and Shaw Cross. They're both places they had confrontations. The Americans negotiated between the Chinese, mediated between the Chinese and Philippines, got them both to withdraw. Philippines withdraw, China withdrew. 2 months later, Chinese came right back and sat. So Philippines then went to the tribunal, made a lot of noise about how illegal what Chinese were doing was. Tribunal gave a verdict 100% in their favor, saying it's all wrong what China is doing, island building, etc. Philippines elected a new president, Duterte, who said, what problem? Forget the tribunal. We're not interested in that. I'll deal directly with the Chinese. And he went to China and he said, we have no problem with the Chinese on South China Sea. And the rest of the world was left watching. He told the Americans, he called Obama all kinds of names. And he said, so suddenly again, 2 weeks ago, now of course there are large parts of the Philippine hierarchy there, the military for instance, and the traditional front office and so on, who are very angry with this. But you can't go on flip-flopping on matters of territorial integrity. But Duterte said, so I'd be very nervous of saying I'll fight for somebody else's rights when he's not willing to fight for it consistently. And anyway, it's his rights. And we can coordinate in terms of how we regard international law on the issue or, you know, other things. But I wouldn't get into this business of who actually owns which island. Whether it's Mr. Free, whether it's Bradley's, whether it's Paris's. I'd be very careful about that. Even the US, who is a treaty ally of the Philippines, actually doesn't pronounce on the actual territorial status of those islands or those areas. So I'm not sure that we need to, and how does Philippines add to our ability to deal with the Chinese?
The South China Sea.
But what does Philippines do for us? Philippines is not going to guarantee freedom of navigation. So it might feel good that, oh, we stood together and we stood up and we yelled. But what does it actually do for my interests, for my hard, real interests? That's the question you need to ask for any of these arrangements. Somebody is asking you to support his stand and so on. I think you need to actually boil it down to, okay, what's in it for me? And be pretty hard-hearted about this. Be a realist.
We have time for another two questions. Two questions. So, yeah. Please.
One there, one there.
On the, there also. Three more questions. Three more questions. Four. Okay, four.
Sir, I'm Ananya from IBM 2. Sir, I wanted to clarify one of your statements. While you were giving, talking about the Indo-China complications, you said that why is China pushing so much? It can slowly build on its projects. But the road China is trying to build over the border on which we have the conflict, it is one of the projects of China. But can we allow that project of China? Like, it is
the road in Doklam?
Yes, sir.
That's not part of BRI. That's just a track which they've been widening and now they want to bring, they brought in a bulldozer and they probably want to put some tiles on it. That's not part of the big BRI that they did, or the Belt and Road Initiative. But we've stopped it by physically preventing it. So no, I don't think we can allow it.
We'll have one question from here, and then there, and then here.
So you said that China needs to shift to a more domestic consumption model, and they have been thinking about it. But I do not see that happening, especially when they're pushing so aggressively for the Belt and Road Initiative. And so how do you see that shift in their economy happening over the next few years? From an export-oriented model to a more domestic consumption model.
You know, in fact, that's part of the problem. One reason why I said that, you know, diminished capacity. When Xi Jinping came to power, and they saw this quite clearly that they had to shift from export-led growth to domestic growth and so on. Third plenum of the Central Committee in 2013 passed a huge resolution of all the economic reforms that they were going to do, which was basically move to a market-led economy, move to domestic consumption-led growth, deal with all the debt burden, especially what the provinces have probably done, state-owned enterprise, reorganization, etc. And the list is very long. Less than 10% of that has actually been implemented now, 4.5 years after that. And, you know, he chose third plenum because it has huge resonance. Deng's reforms were actually passed at the third plenum of the 10th Party Central Committee. in 1978. So he chose his big economic reform package and broke. But the fact is, it hasn't been implemented. Chinese official figures will tell you that they have actually shifted demand, that growth in the economy is now coming from domestic demand, from domestic consumption. But that's because they add government spending to domestic consumption, unlike the rest of us. So they actually conflate it all and say, see, 70% of demand is actually. But this is what the government is spending, and everything in China is government one way or the other, including. So a lot of it is administrative pump priming rather than natural domestic demand growing. And that's why I say they have a problem. That because they want to do it, they know the solution, but they haven't managed to do it. And they haven't managed to do it despite this great centralization of power. The Chinese call Xi Jinping now president of everything, because he has 12 jobs, which nobody ever has had in this position before. In the past, Deng Xiaoping's only job was chairman of the Bridge Committee of the Bridge Association of China. And he ran China quite happily from behind the screen. So there is a real problem there, which I'm not sure how they're going to solve. There's no simple answer. When you look at, unless you reform the state-owned enterprises, unless you let private in consumption go, but then what happens to your savings rate? It'll drop tremendously. And right now, that's what's keeping you going. It's constant infusion of government money. We lived with the consequences of that. We did that after 2008. And you saw the consequences in 2012-13 in the Indian economy of too much money being pushed in just to keep the economy going. And you saw that, and you saw what happened. That's in a relatively open economy where government control is maybe nowhere near as much as in China. But I'm not sure how they'll manage, how they'll square the circle at all. If you have the answer, the Chinese will pay you $1 million.
Considering
that in some way CPC is targeting Indian interest, why does China want India to join?
Actually, China doesn't want you to join because there is nothing to join. There's no one agreement, there's no body, here's the Belt and Road Initiative. What they wanted you to do was to attend the Belt and Road Forum and say, wow, what a wonderful idea this is. And isn't Xi Jinping a great man, the leader, the natural leader of the world? That's what they wanted. And that you didn't do. Right? You chose not to do it. You could have done it differently also. You could have gone and not said it. And said instead that only those bits of this which make economic sense, if they are open to everybody, if this is inclusive, if it builds connectivity in Asia and the world, that we like, we will work with that. But there are bits that give us problems. You could have done that also. And you had various options. But you chose one. For whatever reason, the government knows best what it's doing. And I think that is what they... But they never asked you, please sign this common agreement, or we're setting up a body to oversee Belt and Road. Which you would expect at some kind of advisory council, at least to claim that you've involved the rest of the world in your project. Nothing. It was just a sheer display of power, as far as I could see. But that's what politics is about. It's about alpha males and their problems.
My name is Omkar. I'm faculty in the operations area. The question is not related only with China. I agree at one level that on the political and the economic side, government takes a leading decision making. But what are the other societal components which can play a role in improving relations with neighboring countries?
In China?
All other neighboring countries, for example. Various components like the cultural components, filming, sporting, or various components to improve the country-to-country level relations, apart from government.
If you're bothered about state-to-state relations, then it really varies from country to country. The Pakistani state policy is determined by the army. It doesn't really matter what the rest of Pakistan or the other little Pakistans do or think. It really doesn't matter. You can cultivate them because you want to, limit the circle of your enmity, but these ones are going to be hostile. In other countries, in Bangladesh, for instance, it matters, because they have a functioning political system, they have mass-based political parties, you know, they have also a political discourse which is much more than just the traditional West Asian one where religion plays a major part, not at all, in fact, in Bangladesh, the opposite. So it's worth your while using everything that you say, whether it's culture, whether it's games, whether it's whatever, you know, public opinion matters. Same in Sri Lanka. Public opinion matters, civilian politicians matter. So you have to work through both. In each place, it depends on what you have to look at the place and then decide what you want to do. I don't think there's one formula. Yes, you have a big toolkit of things, and you what we've done is expanded the toolkit in the last 20, 25 years. Whether it's we've added, you know, free trade agreements and economic diplomacy strengthened. We now have foundations which promote scholarship, people-to-people exchanges, you know, artistic exchanges with each of our neighbors, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, all of them. We have, and these foundations, both governments have put money in steadily, so that this goes on outside the, you know, government changes, this shouldn't stop. Normal business. So we've expanded the toolkit successfully, I think, over the last few years. But there's no one recipe that I would use for all in it.
On behalf of IIM Indore, the Special Interest Group on India-China, I very humbly thanks Ambassador Vishen Kumbhanan for having come here and enlightening us with his talk and sharing his views during some of the questions that you know, many in the audience had to raise. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And maybe again in future, we would like to have you again. Thank you, sir.